Thank you, Matt. I'm not sure this is exactly what will happen some years after the cartilage lesions, but I want to give some overview of what we listened before and directly apply to football. And this is a conference I update. I presented with UEFA a few years ago under the direction of Michel Doug in Madrid, and I want to discuss this cartilage lesions. This is my disclosure. I have no specific conflict of interest, and I use this three major book to try to find the right information applied to football. As you know, it's important to know the natural history. When there is a cartilage lesions, there is very limited spontaneous repair because there is no vascularization, no inflammatory process, no recruitment or undifferentiated cells. And there is inability for replication and repair. So it's not a good news, because if we do nothing, it cannot repair. But the evolution is very long, as you know, and it can take sometimes 20 to 30 years to lead to osteoarthritis. And when there is a cartilage lesions, it can limit the ability to play for the footballer, and also it predispose them for joint deterioration and disability. And so the natural history of this cartilage lesions is to become osteoarthritis over time. And the question is to know how we can prevent this. You know probably better than me the different layers of the cartilage, but what is important is this specific zone of transition between the cartilage and the subchondral bone with a tie mark, and this is what is the most difficult to reproduce when we use different techniques. I want just to give some information about the etiology of this osteochondral defect that was underlined by Philippe Landreau. And also, we discussed this different technique of cartilage repair, but also there is a new technique that was discussed by Mats Bredberg I want to discuss with you. First, the etiology. And of course, when there is some injury that is very common in football, we can observe ligament, meniscal, and cartilage lesions. And it involves mainly the hip, the knee, and the ankle. But the way the cartilage damage occurs is different for the hip and knee, and often there is a primary impact. And when this is a knee and ankle, it could be also secondary lesions due to ligament insufficiency. So we have globally three different techniques, and I want to highlight these three techniques. There is a palliative technique, the reparative technique, and the restorative technique. And when we want to try to restore the cartilage, this is also in order to prevent the onset of osteoarthritis. So the first technique that was discussed before were the palliative technique. And we have to really understand that this very simple technique that is arthroscopic debridement, abrasion arthroplasty, abrasion chondroplasty, it represents in fact 85% of the gesture around the world. And even if we discuss a lot about more sophisticated technique, until today most of the surgeons are just doing this kind of gesture around the world. So if we go to the reparative technique, there is different type, and we didn't discuss a lot about the perforation described in the past by Pridey, and we will focus just 2 minutes about the microfracture we discussed before. The principle is to create an access to the subchondral bone marrow, and then some stem cells come to this prepared cartilage defect, and there is a transformation predominantly in hyaline-like cartilage issue. And you see in this picture the blood, and we imagine the stem cell that arrive. This is easy and fast to accomplish, very cheap. We can do it by arthroscopy, but the problem are the quality of the tissue is not good, and if we want to prepare the future, this is not a good option. We can observe some ossification in into this formation of the tissue, and there is a limited durability of this procedure. So that, if we want to stop the onset of osteoarthritis, this is not the best option. We discuss also the osteochondral graft. It could be allograft, as described just before by Scott, and also it could be a mosaic plasty. And you see again what is in favor. It's cheap. We can obtain a good and predictable cartilage, and also we could do, but this is not so easy, perform this with a minimally invasive technique. But again, it's very difficult to have a good surface congruency. This is not so certain. We have a perfect integration in the horizontal plane, and we saw that there is some donor site morbidity. So some surgeons developed, and particularly Lars Peterson and Matt Brisberg, some restorative technique with the ACI and also matrix chondrocyte implantation. And you see here the first article. It was very well described before. I don't want to give too much details, but the principles are very simple. We harvest some cartilage. The cartilage is prepared with some mechanical and enzymatic digestion. And then there is an expansion of the chondrocyte. And later, a few weeks later, the chondrocytes are implanted and to fill the cartilage defect. So there is again some advantage. The quality of the tissue we obtain is good. And this is also something that was really well studied by the Swedish team, and results are reported with a very long term, but it needs two operations. We need to perform an arthrotomy. It's not so simple to perform this kind of surgery, and we need really to have experts that train. And also, it costs a lot of money. And for example, in France, we cannot do it. We are not rich often anymore. And we can improve this technique using some characterized chondrocyte. And this specific chondrocyte are able to produce cartilage that is very close to the hyaline cartilage, and the quality of this chondrocyte seems to be superior. So there is also some recommendation probably to use this type of cartilage. And then the next step is to introduce this chondrocyte in a matrix so that there is not only some chondrocytes that are acting in different way, but in a really in a good 3D dimension so that it could have a better effect. And this is a principle of the MASI with a synthetic matrix. And for example, we study that with the CartiPatch in the past, where we place this type of chondrocyte in some matrix in order to orientate the multiplication of the chondrocyte. So what we know and what is interesting is if we consider the general population, the surgical treatment is effective, and some authors were able to report an algorithm so that we have some idea how to manage this type of cartilage defect. But it becomes much more difficult when it comes to soccer. And in fact, when there is some soccer player, we can distinguish a recreational player and a professional player. And they have different expectations. And recreational players mainly want to have some pain relief. They want to return of functionality so that they want to return to work, have a normal daily life, and sometimes to be able to practice football. But when it's a professional player, it's very different. They want a fast return to high level. They have no real concern of joint damage. And this is particularly true when they have a short career. If they are 30 years, it's very different of player of 18 years. And this is sometimes a real dilemma for the physician because he has sometimes to follow the expectation of the patient, but he knows that choosing this option, probably the knee joint will be destroyed a few years later. So this is something really like ethics, and this is really interesting to discuss this point. Whatever the method we use, these three methods, football players with successfully return to competition are the patient we treat with a short delay between the injury and the surgery. It means less than 12 months. This is mainly the young player. It's very different if we compare player under 25 and over 30. And also, we need to perform early surgery when the symptoms appear. This is also an important information, particularly in professional athletes, and it was very well described in the previous presentation. But notice here the huge difference between the two options, microfracture and osteochondral autologous transplantation, where the patient is able to return to sports after 7 to 8 months, and after ACI, where it takes 18 months. This is a mean value. So this is really a huge difference. But of course, if we perform a microfracture, the quality of the cartilage is not the same than if we perform ACI. And over the time, the quality of the cartilage is better, and also the functional score are better. So we have these three options, and these three different options. And I want again to underline the short delay. That is really for the football players sometimes what is important. And in professional footballer who wants to continue their career for at least a couple of years, microfracture is mainly considered as the first treatment option. So this is, and it's very difficult to convince the patient for another choice. So this is a different cartilage repair we have. We can also consider the new frontier, viscosupplementation. This is not something that is proved as efficient, but in fact, it's not a risky proposition, so that it's something we can perform once a patient had a recent injury. PRP was discussed before. There is not really evidence also to use it, but again, this is something that a patient wants to try, and even if there is no evidence, this is often proposed to the different patient. What about the future? This is what we would like to do. This is our holy grail. It would be to produce hyaline cartilage with a well-integrated and flexible subchondral base and the normal zone variability. And this is what we would like to obtain in the next year. there is different option for the future to consider. This is first when what we call the cartilage autoimplantation. This is some fragment of cartilage that are fragmented and embedded in a 3D polymeric resorbable scaffold. And this is a way to consider. And we discuss also the possibility to use some mesenchymal stem cells. And the advantage, it could be done in only one step surgery. We can harvest some bone marrow and then concentrate these stem cells and inject them and also use a membrane to isolate these stem cells. Also, we can combine stem cells and PRP, and this is also a way that is now developed. And since many years, since 20 years, we are speaking about gene therapy, and even the people that were very involved in this field didn't report spectacular result until now. And recently, you know, probably one of the last Nobel Prize in physiology and medicine was a Japanese. And this Japanese, and it's not so common, was an orthopedic surgeon. And recently, I had the opportunity to listen to his conference. And he said that, unfortunately, the cartilage will be the last issue we will study in the next year, and it's much easier to work on the heart cells, brain cells, liver cells, than cartilage cells. So that I think we have to wait, like in many fields, when we are an orthopedic surgeon. Whatever, what we can say is we need to tailor the treatment to each patient, really to take into consideration his expectation. I am relatively disappointed with this cartilage management since 20 years, and we have to do this type of gesture with caution because it's not so easy. And even if the goal is to prevent cartilage deterioration over time, I am not sure that until now we are able to propose a very good solution. But I don't want to finish with this pessimistic things. And I would like to thank first Philippe Landreau for organizing this such a meeting. I want also to thank Michel Doug and also Yacine for representing FIFA. And I think we had very exciting days, these two last days. And I really enjoy to be with you here in Doha. Thank you.